Welcome to the Florence Kopplef Recital Hall here at the Georgia State University School of Music. Please take a moment to silence all electronic devices. We would like to remind you that there is no food, drink, or flash photography allowed in the recital hall. Thank you for visiting the Georgia State University School of Music, and please enjoy the performance.
Thank you. wrote his fourth violin sonata during a very transformational period in his life. Beethoven finished composing it in 1801. By that time, he already started to lose his hearing. 1 year later, he would write his famous Heiligenstadt Testament, and in it he wrote of the painful hearing condition he already started to have, and he told no one of this painful secret. But then, throughout the Testament, he also tells us that he was contemplating committing suicide and ending his life. However, in the end, he decides to persevere and sacrifice his life to music. So Beethoven struggled between utter despair and love for life and music is heard all throughout the first and third movements of the sonata. And this bipolarity does eventually become Beethoven's style. Now, the second movement is very interesting because the world and with or because of it, the arts were going through a shift from the classical to the romantic period. And Beethoven, in the second movement, pays homage and reminisces on the classical style of his predecessors, Haydn and Mozart. Lastly, this is not a sonata for violin with like the accompaniment of piano. This is Beethoven specifies by naming it sonata for violin and piano, which equalizes the playing field, makes me feel much less important. And with that, I would like to welcome my sister, Susanna Gordon, onto the stage.
Thank you. Thank you.
that were originally scored for an orchestra or solo piano. An American in Paris is an orchestral piece by Gershwin describing a random, carefree American with a somewhat bubbly personality, skipping his way with amazement through the crazy streets of Paris. Young men chasing women, parties are perpetual, drunkard playing 12-bar blues.
Thank you.
Florence had a very particular style of composition. She was trained in the classical European style at the New England Conservatory, you can even see this influence in the names of her pieces. For example, Elfentanz in German is elf dance. And as far as I remember, you're welcome to fact check me, there are no elves in Arkansas. Florence was also very committed to her Christian faith and commonly used music from the African American church in her music. And so she displays this juxtaposition of the classical European and the African American styles in the majority of her works. Elfentanz is a perfect example of this unique style.
Thank you.
want to thank Holly Kelly and the Denison family for letting me play this wonderful instrument on my recital. This violin is 90 years old, and Holly's mother, Catherine, used to play this violin, and it has remained in the family since then. Catherine was the concert mistress of the Atlanta Symphony Youth Orchestra, which later evolved into the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra under Robert Shaw and my mentor, Maestro Palmer, in the 1960s. Catherine and her sisters also were very well known in the musical community of Atlanta and performed together as a quartet and in other various ensembles all over Atlanta. I am genuinely grateful to be playing this beautiful instrument on my recital in the heart of Atlanta, where perhaps it belongs. I don't think I have to say anything else about the Chrysler. The piece speaks for itself.
Thank you.
Before we begin, I would like to thank you all again for coming, and thanks to everyone who's watching the live stream. I forgot to thank my parents, and now I'm going to do that, so thank you to my parents for everything, literally. This piece is very important to me, this aria from Bach's St. Matthew Passion. I spent the whole junior year of my, the whole fall semester of my junior year studying this with Maestro Palmer, and the Colossal work had such an impact on me that I contemplated becoming a Bach-only musician, that is a musician that that spends and gives his whole life just to Bach, and you know, but how I remembered that Bach, that Beethoven and Mozart also exists, so that was kind of went away. This aria is from part two of Bach's St. Matthew Passion, and and it's about the betrayal of Peter and the denial of Peter. Throughout the aria, the piano plays the tonal imagery of Peter's tears, and also there's throughout the aria there's continuous appoggiaturas and suspensions that speak of the emotional turmoil of